Praise the Lord. We are grateful to God and giving Him all glory and honor and praise, even in this day when we are concluding 2020, entering into 2021. It is a great time to give praise and glory unto God. So I welcome you to this program, to this sharing in Jesus' name. That the Lord will minister to you and that the Lord will use us as His vessels. Let's begin together with a word of prayer. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you for your faithfulness, O God, in the year 2020. We thank you, Lord, as we enter to begin the new year 2021. Lord, we lay our lives before you. Lord, we put our trust in you. You who knows the days ahead, you who knows the end from the beginning. Lord of glory, we magnify you. We lay our lives before you, that you will minister unto us, that you will speak unto us, that your name shall be glorified. So bless the viewer, the listener, in the name of Jesus. Thank you, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. My name is Sakai Ongeno. I love the Lord Jesus Christ, and I thank God for this opportunity. I thank God for my fellow worker who is doing this recording, our sister and daughter Margaret Ndara. So the Lord bless you. I want to read a scripture that we have read another time in the book of Mark chapter 5. Mark chapter 5. And it is, I'm going to read just the verses from verse 18. Mark chapter 5, the Gospel of Mark chapter 5, verse 18. The Bible says, and when he was come into the ship, he that had been possessed with the devil prayed him that he might be with him. Howbeit, Jesus suffered him not, but said unto him, go home to thy friends and tell how great things the Lord had done for thee and has had compassion on thee. And he departed and began to publish in Decapolis how great things Jesus had done for him. And all men did marvel. Praise the Lord. That portion of scripture is about a man that was possessed by demons, and he used to live in tombs, in graveyards. That was where he spent his life, day and night. The Bible says he was there crying. He was there just screaming, and people had made every attempt to arrest him, to capture him, to chain him with all forms of chains, all manner of fetters for binding, or handcuffs, the ones that policemen use to handcuff people, and you become, your hands are just like powerless, they can do nothing. People had attempted every kind of chain to bind this man who used to live in tombs or in places, a place of graveyard, a graveyard. The word of God tells us that it was a place called Gadarenes. Gadarenes. That was where he was, and that was where he spent his life. He was totally demon possessed. When we read the word of God in that chapter from the beginning, we find that a legion of demons, so many demons were in his life. If we use the number of the pigs that Jesus allowed those demons who were coming out of him to go into, if we use the number, then there were 2,000 demons inside of that man. And so he was operating by demon power. He was operating on demonic power to break all those chains, those shackles, whenever he was bound. And no one could tame him. He could not be tamed by anybody. Praise the Lord. That was the kind of person that he was before Jesus met him. That was the kind of person he was. He lived in mountains, the Bible says, night and day. And he was crying and cutting himself, which is the habit of people that are demon-possessed or who are operating in witchcraft power, like those in the days of Elijah, the prophets of Baal. At one point, they were cutting themselves so that blood could ooze. That was the kind of person he was. And I want to refer to the passage which I have used in times before in chapter 4 of the same book of Mark, the same gospel of Mark. Then, at the end of chapter 4, what we are reading is a time when Jesus Christ told his disciples that we cross over from one side of the lake to the other side. Jesus said to his disciples, let us pass over unto the other side. Let us cross over unto the other side. And Jesus did not tell his disciples what was in between, what was going to happen in the lake, in the sea as they crossed over. He didn't tell them. He kept that as a secret. And so the Bible tells us that as they began their journey, Jesus was asleep. He was sleeping behind the boat. He was sleeping somewhere in the stern with a cushion where he laid his head. And he was asleep. And as they went across the lake, there was a mighty storm that arose. The Bible tells us that there was a great storm. There is a breaking out of a great storm that of wind that shook the boat, and water began to enter into the boat. And it entered to the point that it was beginning to sink. And so the disciples, out of fear, they began to cry and to shout or wake up the Lord who was asleep. They woke up the Lord, as we know, and they began to say, Master, don't you care that we are going to perish? Don't you care that we are drowning? Don't you care that we are sinking? Don't you care? It just tells us what kind of the level of faith they had when they were tested by that storm, the kind of level of faith they were entered into by fear. The spirit of fear was taking over them, and like faith was oozing out of them, and now fear was operating in them. And so when they woke up the Lord did not bother to rebuke them at the start. The Lord commanded the storm, commanded the winds, and he said, peace be still, peace be calm. He commanded the storms to be calm. Praise the Lord. And the Bible tells us that the winds ceased, the storms ceased, and there was a great calm in the sea, in the ocean, in this lake rather. There was a great calm. A great calm came upon the sea, the ocean, the lake, when Jesus commanded the winds to cease and said, peace be still. Praise the Lord. That is the mighty God we serve. It's the mighty God we serve. And after he commanded the winds and there was great calm, then that is when Jesus turned to the disciples and asked them, why are you so fearful? Why has fear entered into you? Don't you know? I suppose he was asking that question in another way. Don't you know to whom you belong? Don't you know who is with you? You know, we are living in days, my brethren, my brother, my sister, you are the viewer. We are living in days when we must know to whom we belong. When we must know whose we are, whose we belong, whose we are. Praise God. I think you remember the story, if I can call it a Bible story, of Apostle Paul, who equally was going through a storm in the shipwreck of Acts chapter 27, when they were going and there was such a great thunderstorm that broke into their ship. And the ship was scattered, the ship was broken down, and the Bible says at one point they had come to a point where they had lost all hope of being alive, all hope that they will make it across while alive was gone. All hope was gone. Praise the Lord. That was the incident in Acts chapter 27. And the Bible tells us about Paul, who was among those sailors as a prisoner. He was being taken to Rome. And he received a word from the Lord. It is an angel of the Lord visited him, appeared to him, to speak to him. And he began to address those sailors who were going with him. And he was telling them, the God to whom I belong, the God whom I serve, whom I serve. I'm saying we are living in a day when we must know to whom we belong. Whose are we? Whose are we? I wish I could quickly get that chapter 27. It has just come to me as I was sharing this in Acts chapter 27. Because the ship was caught up and it broke up in the wind and they had lost all hope. All hope. I say all hope. The Bible says, tells us so. But Paul received a word from the Lord in the midst of that storm. He received a word from the Lord. I want to read from Acts chapter 27. I didn't have this. That's just the Lord, the Holy Spirit had just dropped it in my heart. It says, for there stood by me, Paul is speaking now to his fellow prisoners who are in the ship. Let me begin from verse 22. And now I exhort you to be of good cheer. To be of good cheer, for there shall be no loss of any man's life among you. There shall be no loss of any man's life among you, except of the ship. The ship will be destroyed, but there shall be no loss of life. That is what Paul was telling the fellow prisoners, the sailors that were with him in that shipwreck. And he continues to say, for there stood by me this night the angel of God, whose I am and whom I serve. I'm saying we are living in a time when we must know to whom we belong. Whose are we? And whom do we serve? We must know. Praise the Lord. We must know who is in the boat with us. We must know that we belong to the Lord. We belong to a mighty God. We are serving a mighty God. Praise the Lord. In these perilous times, it's like those times of the storms. It's like those times of the shipwreck of Apostle Paul. When the storms were beating upon the ship. It's like those times. They are perilous times. We are living in perilous times. And what we need in order to remain afloat, to remain strong, is we must know whose we are and whom we serve. That is what Paul is saying. And the angel of God, God, whose I am and whom I serve, and that angel was telling me, saying, fear not, Paul. Fear not, Paul. Fear not, fear. Fear not, Paul. Thou must be brought before Caesar, and lo, God has given thee all them that are sailing with you. God has given them into your hands, Paul. God has given them into your hands. They will, their lives will be spared because of you, Paul. Because of you, their lives will be spared. God has given them to you. As I will spare your life, Paul, and you will appear before Caesar, you will appear before Caesar, I will spare the people that are sailing together with you. Praise God. So I'm saying, we are living in a time when we must know whose we are and whom we serve. To whom do we belong? We belong to whom? We belong to Almighty God. Praise God. So Jesus was asking the disciples, why are you so fearful? Why has fear entered into your hearts? That to the extent that you have no faith anymore. That you have no faith because of the storms, because of the perilous times. Praise God. We shall stay afloat. We shall keep our faith by knowing to whom we belong and whom we serve. Amen. So, the Bible tells us back in Mark chapter 4, the Bible tells us that the disciples, they fear exceedingly, and they say to one another, what manner of man is this? They had not known the Lord to that extent. They had not known the Lord as much. They had not known the Lord what level or what much authority he had. And they were saying, what manner of man is this? That even the wind and the sea obey him. Praise God. We serve a God. We belong to a God whom the storms and the winds and the sea, they must obey him. Praise God. The times, the situations, the conditions, the perilous times, they are under his authority. They obey our God. They obey our God. And we must know that we belong to this God. Praise God. Amen. That was the end of chapter 4 of the book of Mark. And that as they crossed over. And so through that storm and through that testing and through that shaking, they came to learn or to know of another aspect of the Lord. They got a greater understanding, a greater knowledge of the Lord to whom they belonged. Amen. Now, crossing over, remember the Lord told them, let us pass over, let us cross over to the other side. Crossing over to the other side in chapter 5 of Mark, which we have read, it is a place called Gadarenes. Chapter 5 verse 1 says, and they came over unto the other side of the sea. The side that Jesus was saying, let us cross over. They came over to the other side of the sea into the country of the Gadarenes. And that is when now they met this man. The moment they came out of the ship, the moment they came on shore, Jesus and them, this man came. This man was demon possessed. He came out of the tombs. He came out of the graveyards. This man was possessed by an unclean spirit. He came, and that is where the Bible is saying his dwelling place was in mountains, his dwelling place was in tombs, and no one could bind him. No one could chain him. They had attempted with all manner of chains, all manner of fetters, all manner of shackles, all manner of handcuffs, but he broke off all of them by demon power. And no one could tame him. Nobody could tame him. But the moment Jesus landed with his disciples on this other side, this man came running and he knelt down before the Lord. Let me read a portion of it. And he said in chapter 5 of Mark chapter 5, it says, but when he saw Jesus afar off, he ran and worshipped him, and cried with a loud voice and said, what have I to do with thee, Jesus, thou Son of the Most High God? I adjure thee by God that you torment me not. For he said unto them, come out of the man, you unclean spirit. And he asked him, what is thy name? Jesus is asking the demons that were in the man, what is your name? And the demons in them, the unclean spirits in him, in him said, my name is Legion, for we are many. And indeed there were many. 2,000 demons in one man. 2,000 demons in one man. He was terribly demon-possessed. Demon-possessed. It was just like Satan in physical, in incarnate. It was like Satan incarnate, in or Satan in the flesh. That is what it was like. Praise God. And they were beseeching Jesus, the demon speaking in this man, they were beseeching this Jesus that he would not send them away from that country. And the Bible tells us that there was a herd of pigs in that place. And the devils were begging Jesus. They were begging Jesus that he would send them. He would cast them out of the man and be driven to enter into the pigs. And the Bible says, forthwith Jesus gave them permission. He gave them leave to enter into those pigs. And when they entered into the pigs ran down the steep hill into the sea. And they all perished. They drowned. They drowned in the sea. Praise the Lord. And so the people that were feeding the swine or the pigs, they ran into the city to report it. The Bible tells us that they went to report it. And they reported what had been done. And so many people came. And when they came, I want to read verse 15. When these people then came, when the city came to see what had happened to this man, when they came to Jesus and they saw him who was possessed with the devil and had the legion, that is many demons in him, thousands of demons in him. And when they saw that man who had been possessed by demons, when they saw him sitting and he was clothed properly and he was in his right mind, they were all afraid of the great things that Jesus had done. Praise the Lord. And when they saw it, and they that saw it told them how it befell, how it happened, how the man was possessed, how the demons were cast, how they went into the pigs, how the pigs were drowned. Praise God. Hallelujah. So I want to read again where I started, because that is where my focus is. And when he was come into the ship, in verse 18, when he was come into the ship, he that had been possessed with the devil prayed him. He was begging Jesus now in his proper mind, in his right mind, in his sound mind. A man who was possessed by demons, a legion of demons, thousands of demons, is now in his right mind, is now in sound mind, properly dressed, properly clothed, and is begging Jesus that he would accompany Jesus. He would go with Jesus. He's not going back to the mountains, to the tombs, to the graveyards. He's in his sober mind delivered, and he wants to follow Jesus. But this is what the Lord said to him. Howbeit, Jesus suffered him not. Jesus did not allow him to accompany him. Jesus rather said to him, go home to your friends. Go home to your city. Now that you are in your right mind, now that you are back as a normal human being that is delivered, go to your friends and tell them the great things. Tell them how great things that the Lord has done for you. How God has shown you compassion. How the Lord has had compassion, has had mercy on you. Go to your city. Go to your friends. Go to your neighbors. Go to your relatives. Tell them the great things that the Lord has done for you. Praise the Lord. And the Bible tells us the man departed. The man departed. The man went. He went and he began to publish. He began to declare it. He began to declare what the Lord had done to him. He began to declare. He began to preach the great things that the Lord had done for him in Decapolis, My understanding of Decapolis there is that it was not just one city. It was a number of cities. Praise the Lord. Because the word Deca means ten. Ten. So it could have been a group of 10 cities, maybe near to each other. I suppose something like that. So I began to publish in those 10 cities, publishing the great things that the Lord had done. He departed and he began to publish in Decapolis how great things Jesus had done for him. Praise the Lord. And men marveled. People marveled at the great things that God had done. Why am I reading this at the beginning of the year? I'm reading this to tell us that God is crossing us over to a time of great things that God will do. A time of great things that God will do. We are crossing over to a time of great things that God will do through his people, through the church, through you and through me. He will do great things. Hallelujah. Praise God. And people will publish. People will publish. People will preach, declare the great things that the Lord has done. Amen. In the time in which we are going, in the year in which we are growing, going into. Praise the Lord. We are crossing over to a time of great things. Hallelujah. Amen. A time when God will use you. God will use me. God will use his church to do great things, to do great things like Jesus did here. And he was telling the man who was now in his right mind, who had been delivered, whom the Lord had delivered, and when no man could have chained him, no man could have tamed him. The great things that the Lord had done, we are crossing over, we are passing over into a time of great things that the Lord will do through his people. Hallelujah. You are one of those people that the Lord will do great things through them in the name of Jesus. And so I'm declaring in the name of Jesus. I've been thinking what has been coming into my heart at this time when there has been a year. 2020 was a year unique here. Unique here in the sense of the things that happened, that came, schools had to shut, churches for the first time for 4 months, we could not gather, we could not assemble, and even now we are assembling at social distance. It was a unique year. It has been a season at a time when it was like shipwreck, when people lost hope, when things were scattered. Praise God. It has been a unique year, a year of its kind, an unforgettable year, 2020. And we are entering into a different year in the name of Jesus. We are entering into a time when the Lord will do great things. Praise the Lord. Praise God. Amen. And so I'm relating it to a time. I want to use the same scripture of Acts 27. As well as a scripture in Job chapter 14, which I'm going to read to conclude with. You see, in that time of the shipwreck of Acts chapter 27, the Bible tells us that everyone had lost hope of being alive, of crossing over alive. Everyone had lost all hope of crossing alive. But Paul began to speak to them and began to say, "Fear not. Because the God to whom I belong, whom I serve, he sent an angel to me to tell me that no life will be lost. No life will be lost except the ship. The ship will break apart, but no life will be lost. You will cross over. So be of good cheer," he was telling them. "Be of good cheer. I'm telling you to be of good cheer. We are entering into a year where the Lord will do great things in the name of Jesus. We are crossing over into the fullness of God's visitation, into the fullness of the revival of God. We are crossing over. We are crossing over into a time when God will do great things." And so I want to tell you, maybe you lost hope. Maybe somewhere in 2020, you were at the point of being hopeless. You were at the point of being of having no hope. I want to tell you, like Paul was telling those people who had lost all hope of ever crossing over alive. They had lost all hope. They had reached a point of total hopelessness, but no life was lost in the name of Jesus. Praise God. So I want to read from the book of Job chapter 14, a scripture in Job chapter 14, which I will conclude with in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name, remember, I'm encouraging you in the name of the Lord. It says there in Job chapter 14, I want to read from verse 7. It says, "For there is hope of a tree, if it be cut down, that it will sprout again, and that the tender branch thereof will not cease. Though the root thereof wax old in the earth, and the stalk thereof die in the ground, yet through the scent of water it will bud, and bring forth boughs like a plant." Praise God. So that I want to compare us, you and I, the church as a whole, I want to compare us to this plant at this time, to this plant that is spoken about in Job chapter 14, beginning verse 7 to 9. The Bible tells us that we are the planting of the Lord. We are the Lord's plant. So we are like that tree. We are like that plant. Praise the Lord. We are the planting of the Lord. We are the trees of righteousness. The Bible calls us so. The trees of righteousness, the planting of the Lord. Isaiah 61. Amen. So the Bible is saying there is hope of a tree when it has been cut down. When it has been cut down to the point of just being a stump. Something just remaining like a stump. A stump. There is hope. The Bible is saying there is hope. Remember, we have talked about a people that had reached a place where they had lost all hope of ever crossing over alive. But the Bible is saying there is hope. There is hope. I want to say to you, there is hope. In the name of Jesus, we are crossing over to a time when the Lord will do great things, which will be published in cities like Decapolis, like it was done in Decapolis by one man who had been brought from being demon-possessed by a legion of demons to a point of being of right mind. Hallelujah. Glory to God. I'm saying there is hope. There is hope of a tree if it be cut down. There is hope that it will sprout again. The year 2020 has been like a year that was cutting down everything, cutting down businesses, cutting down economies of nations, cutting down the faith of many, cutting down. It has been like a time of cutting down. It cut down. Nations had to release trillions and billions of dollars, of pounds, of shillings into their economy to help to sustain. Everything was cut down. But the Bible is saying there is hope of a tree when it is cut down. There is hope that it will sprout again. This has been entering my heart, and I'm speaking with faith. I'm speaking believing what I read in the Word of God, that there is hope for a tree when it has been cut down, that it will sprout again. It will sprout again. So although the year 2020 has been like a year of cutting down, I want to say there is hope. I want to say there will be a sprouting again. There will be a sprouting again. In the name of Jesus, there will be a springing again. In the name of Jesus. And the Bible says, and the tender branch thereof will not cease. The tender branch will not fail. It will not fail because the tree was cut down. The tender branches, that will sprout, that will sprout. They will not cease. They will not fail to bear fruit. Amen. Glory to God. It has been like a year 2020 of like trimming, of like pruning, of like cutting down. But there will be a sprouting again. I'm saying there is hope. I'm saying there is hope. I'm saying there is hope. There is hope in the name of Jesus. We are crossing over. We are crossing over. In, as we enter this year 2021, we are crossing over into a time that the Lord will do great things, which shall be published in cities and in villages, in cities and in villages, through the power of revival. We are crossing over into the fullness of the visitation of God, into the fullness of revival, in the name of Jesus. Let me continue to finish from Job. It says, though the root of the stump, although the root of the stump may wax old in the earth, may wax old, may grow old in the earth, and though the stalk or the stump thereof die, although the stump begin to die, begin to decay, begin to rot in the ground, the Bible says, yet, in verse 9, yet through the scent of water, it will bud. That same stump, which was beginning to rot, that same stump, which had been cut down, and it was growing old in the earth, in the ground, that same stump, that same stalk, the Bible is saying, at the scent of water, at the smell of just a little water, a little shower of water, at the smell, at the scent of water, it will bud, it will sprout again, and it will bring forth branches like a new plant, like a young plant, like a fresh plant. It will send forth branches, it will send forth twigs, it will send forth leaves that produce fruit. Amen. At the smell of water, at the smell of a little water, the little water of the Spirit of God, the little water of the outpouring of the Spirit of God, the water, the spring of water of the Spirit of God, the rains of the water of the Spirit of God, and the smell of that water, the church of Jesus Christ shall sprout again. I said it shall sprout again. It shall sprout again in the name of Jesus. It shall bud again in the name of Jesus. It shall be revived. It shall revive. It shall come back to life. It, though it look like a stump, it shall come back to life in the name of Jesus. So I'm encouraging you. I'm speaking to your life as we begin a new year. I'm saying there is hope, dear viewer. I'm saying there is hope. I'm saying there is hope. I'm saying there shall be a springing up. There shall be a sprouting again. There shall be a re-sprouting, re-sprouting, reviving, reviving. Amen. Glory to God. Glory to God. I want your heart to capture this as we enter this new year. Let your heart capture it in the mighty name of Jesus. We are crossing over to a time the Lord will do great things like he did in Kadarins, like he did in that, to that man, that no man could chain, no man could tame, no man could bind with any form of chain or fetter, of shackle or handcuff. The Lord delivered him from a legion, from thousands of demons, and he became a man of right mind who began to preach the word of God. He began to publish the great things that the Lord had done. That is where we are crossing over into. There is hope. In the name of Jesus, I'm saying there is hope. I'm saying there shall be a sprouting again. In the name of Jesus, there shall be a sprouting again. There shall be a springing again. Tender plants, tender branches will come up and will spread forth in the name of Jesus. I wish I had time to tell of Abraham, whom I intended to tell. Maybe I'll say of them about them in the next program, in the name of Jesus. Maybe I'll speak of them in the next program. I wanted to speak of Joseph, the prophetic word that was spoken of Joseph by his father Jacob. It's very much like where we are entering into. He was compared to a plant that will send forth its branches, cross over the walls, cross over the borders, into nations, into continents. We are going to be like that in the time we are entering, in the season we are entering. There is hope. I'm saying there is hope. I'm saying there is hope in the name of Jesus. So capture the hope that we are entering this new year with hope in Jesus' name. May the Lord bless you, dear viewer. I want to thank you for tuning into this short program that was meant to encourage you, that was meant to strengthen your faith as we begin a new year. In the mighty name of Jesus, in the mighty name of Jesus, dare to know to whom you belong. Know whom you belong. Know whom you serve. Know whose you are. Know that you belong to a mighty God. A mighty God who is going to do great things. Jesus said, let us cross over. Let us pass over. Don't remain with your mind in 2020. Don't remain with your mind in hopelessness. Don't remain with your mind in a cut down stump. You are entering into a time of sprouting again, springing again in the mighty name of Jesus. May the Lord bless you. I'm saying you will spring forth. I'm saying you will sprout again in the mighty name of Jesus. In the mighty name of Jesus, at the smell of just a water that God is going to release, the waters of the Spirit of God, the waters of revival that God will release in the name of Jesus through those waters of the Spirit of God, of the Holy Spirit. You will bud, you will send forth branches like a young plant, like a new plant, a new plant. It looked like it had been cut down, but you will spring forth like a new plant in the mighty name of Jesus. May the Lord bless you. May the Lord cause your business to spring up again. Cause your business to sprout again. May the Lord cause your economy to sprout again. May the Lord cause your faith to sprout again. May the Lord cause whatever you had lost hope about, whatever you had become hopeless about, may the Lord cause even wombs to sprout again. In the name of Jesus, may your health sprout again. May your ministry sprout again in this new year, as we begin a new year, in the mighty name of Jesus. The Lord is with you. Know whom you serve. Know to whom you belong. Know whose you are, in the name of Jesus. I want to conclude in prayer. Heavenly Father, in Jesus' name, we thank you for your word, O God, of edification that you are speaking unto us. We bless your name, O God, as we begin a new year, O God. Lord of glory, let them come to be in our lives, that we shall partake of these great things you will do. You did great things in Gadarenes. You did great things that were published. You did great things that you had to speak to the man who was possessed and was now in his right mind. You told him, Lord Jesus, to go and to publish, to go and declare, to go and to proclaim the great things you had done, the great things you had done. And in every city, in the 10 cities he proclaimed, everyone marveled. Everyone was amazed. Call, Lord of glory, we pray that we shall be partakers of the great things that you will do in the name of Jesus. So cause our spirits, our lives, our minds to cross over, our God, in the name of Jesus. I declare there is hope. I declare there will be a sprouting again in the life of the viewer, in the church of Jesus Christ, in our nation. There shall be a sprouting again in the name of Jesus, and that we shall carry this great revival that will do great things. In the name of Jesus, I pray, Lord, that this, the rain of your Spirit will come upon us And we shall bud as a church. We shall sprout as a church in the mighty name of Jesus. Thank you, Almighty God. Thank you, King of Glory. Let your name be glorified. I pray you bless the viewer. I pray you do great things in their life, in their family, in the name of Jesus, in their ministry, in this new year 2021. Thank you, Almighty God. Receive the glory, the praise, the adoration, the majesty. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray.